So I have already uploaded video on experimental stress analysis on the topics related to strain gauges, where we found strain sensitivity. And we discussed some of the resistance strain gauges also, bounded strain gauge, unbounded strain gauge, weldable, unweldable strain gauges, cemented. So all these things already we have discussed. Then the second most topic also very important, which was photoelasticity, that also we discussed in detail. So that photoelasticity is a very wide area which has to be covered step by step. So we discussed about photoelasticity, and we also discussed about the fringe patterns which were observed when the specimen or test specimen were applied with some type of load and strain developed. Okay, so that bright and dark fringe pattern is being checked, or you can say it is analyzed in Polariscope. So that Polariscope is an instrument. In my discussion on photoelasticity, I did not discuss much more in you can say detail about this Polariscope. So that's what I am going to discuss today about that Polariscope. And I will be discussing about what actually is polarization. I want to give a general concept to my students that what actually is called polarization and what is called polarized light, unpolarized light, what is the difference. So that particular part we are going to have a discussion today. Okay, let us move ahead. So you can see that this particular slide which I am going to show you, and this is actually polarization and polariscope. So this polarization and polariscope is my today's topic, and I need my students' attention very carefully. Why? Because this topic is very important topic. Until unless this, they will not be understanding. So a very good concept they will not be able to build on photoelasticity especially. Okay, so let us have a discussion on this. The very first thing I want to tell you that polarization. So before I start polarization, I will tell you about light. So light and electromagnetic wave I have written. So light is what? Light is a source of energy. Okay. So light is a source of energy. Source of energy. So light is a source of energy, and light is an electromagnetic wave which can travel even in vacuum also. Which can travel even in vacuum also. So that is the beauty that light is there. And light consists of, you can say, charged particles consisting of electrical charge also and magnetic charge also. So it, the particles, light is, you can say light can be considered as a wave also, can be considered as particle also. And already this particular concept has been you can say clearly proved. Okay, it is clearly proved. So this light, which consists of particles which are vibrating in two fields, you know, say I mean to say that one is electrical field and another one is magnetic field. Okay, so these two, electrical field and magnetic field, both are perpendicular to each other. And the light particles are vibrating like this, and it is moving in one particular direction. So light can be considered as a transverse wave. Which wave? Transverse wave. Okay. Transverse wave. Transverse waves are those waves in which particles are oscillating back and forth, up and down, and move perpendicular to the direction. And you can say it is vibrating perpendicular to the direction of motion. So this particular light wave is moving in this direction, but its particles are moving up and down. Okay, so this movement is there. So that is called a transverse wave. So light is a source of energy, and it is an electromagnetic wave that is very necessary to understand for the students. Okay, so that is there. Now, we'll discuss about unpolarized light and polarized light. So what actually it is? If the light, what we receive from our bulb, okay, and from torch light and all, so that lights, or you can say even candle light also, that is actually unpolarized light. Unpolarized light means the vibration of the particle will be in all directions. Okay, the vibration of the particles will be in all directions. So this is actually unpolarized light, this one. So when the vibration of particles in all directions are present, that particular light will be called as unpolarized light. Now, the difference. Polarized light, when the vibration of particles will be limited to only one particular direction, not in all directions, only in one particular direction, then this will be called as polarized light. So this is called polarized light. Now question arises that how we can obtain this polarized light. So there are many methods are there for obtaining this polarized light. Some type of transmission through polaroid. So polaroid actually A-R-O-I-D. So polaroid. Polaroid, some type of instruments are there when the light will be passing through this polaroid, and the light which is emerging out from that polaroid, it will be called as polarized light. Okay. Some type of, you can say, membrane or filter materials are also available. Their chemical designs, their molecules are designed in such a way that it will be allowing only the light to pass through it in one plane itself. So that will be, that can also be done. And even you can say that by going for that scattering phenomena, or by refraction also. Refraction, I hope you all are already knowing. I have already mentioned that in my previous class. Refraction. Okay, so this refraction also is one of the method by which we can obtain polarized light. Similarly, scattering is also one of the method by which we will be able to obtain polarized light. So unpolarized light, when the particles are vibrating in all directions, which generally occurs in broad daylight, or even the bulb which we are glowing, you can say in our home it is there, or tube lights are there, or some type of torch light, emergency light, whatever it is. So immediately the light which is coming out from, even from the candles, okay, lamps, so those lights are unpolarized light because it is consisting of the particles and it is vibrating in all directions. Whereas polarized light is in that particles are vibrating only in one direction. So our requirement is there for polarized light. Okay, so that is called polarization. Next, types of polarization. Now, there is linear polarization, circular polarization, and elliptical polarization. Three types of polarizations polarized light can be produced. Okay, so one is called linear polarization. So linear polarization, in which you can say the particles, or you can say that waves, okay, electrical and magnetic waves will be confined to one particular direction. Okay, will be confined to one particular direction. So in this way, in one direction itself. So that will be called as linear polarization. In one direction only it is there, the movement of particles, both electrical and magnetic field. Okay, so it will be only in one direction. Whereas in circular polarization, so this is related to linear polarization. And whereas for circular polarization, the difference between the two waves, okay, two waves will be in different, you can say both 90 degree difference will be there for both. Okay. In this paper, it will be looking like similar. In this paper, it will be looking both of them, linear polarization and circular polarization, both will be looking similar to it. Okay. So, but actually, the difference between the two axes will be 90 degree difference will be there, and equal magnitude. The magnitude will be equal, like this, it is there. One will be there, another one in this direction, like this, you can say. Okay, so this is circular polarization, in which the difference between the two fields will be 90 degree to each other, and it will be having equal magnitude. So the magnitude of the two fields, electric field and magnetic field, that will be, both of them will be same. Whereas here, equal magnitude will be there, but in the same direction, there will not be any phase difference. What it is called? Phase difference. There will not be any phase difference. So phase difference will be zero here. Will be zero, 0 degree. Okay. Here phase difference, that is phi, is equal to 90 degree. In this case also magnitude will be same. In this case also magnitude will be same, but that phase difference will be 90 degree. In this phase difference will be 0 degree. Now elliptical polarization will be similar to circular polarization. In that case, the magnitude will not be equal. Okay. It will be having a difference of 90 degree phase difference, 90 degree will be there, but that magnitude will be different. Magnitude will not be equal. Okay. So this phase difference is equal to 90 degree, no doubt. The only difference is the magnitude of these two waves, electrical wave and magnetic wave, both will be different. Okay, so that magnitude will be different in this case. So that is called linear polarization, circular polarization, and elliptical polarization, which will be utilizing it in our further when we will discuss about polariscope. Okay. Now, coming to polariscope. So polariscope actually is an optical device. Optical device means wherever we are using light, wherever we are talking about some type of images, wherever we are talking about, you can say, some type of reflection, and scattering, transmission. So whenever these type of things are there, by utilizing light as a source of energy and some type of device through which we will be able to produce some images or some patterns. So that is called optical device. So polariscope is an optical inspection device. Okay, it is an optical inspection device, polariscope. So polariscope is an instrument, is an equipment which is used in photoelasticity to see the pattern of fringes. As I told you that whenever the light rays which are passing through any material, then it produces or you can say the monochromatic light, or you can say polarized light or monochromatic source of light, when it is passing through some material, it produces some type of patterns. So that patterns will be in the form of, in some portion bright light will be there, some portions dark light will be there, in that you can say screen. So if the image of that particular material, if we see in that optical device, then we will be able to find that alternate bright and dark, some patterns will be developed. And these bright and dark patterns are called fringes. These are called fringes. So the same fringe pattern only is being observed in polariscope. And that method is called photoelasticity. So in that strained places where more strain is there, where more stress concentration areas are there, so some dense fringe patterns will be developed in comparison to other portion where stresses are less, or you can say strain is zero. So in that case, that fringe pattern will be showing us, will be telling us that which part is getting more strained. So that thick pattern will be there. Okay. So polariscope is an optical device. We'll see that what is the construction. We'll see. Now transparent materials. So generally, the application of this polariscope is for transparent materials because we need the light to pass through the material. If it is opaque, then we will not be able to produce any type of fringe pattern. Opaque means through which light cannot be passed through. Okay, so it should be transparent material and used for determining stresses and strain. So as I told you that in photoelasticity, we are using polariscope. And what for we are using photoelasticity? In order to determine safe load, in order to determine the extent of strain a material can withstand without structural failure or without much deformation. Okay. So like plastics, glass, synthetic resins, this type of material, we will be able to use it. We are using this photoelasticity process and this polariscope. Okay. Now there are two types of polariscope which are being used in photoelasticity especially. One is called plain polariscope. We'll see in next slide along with the figure. So plain polariscope is there and circular polariscope is there. Two types of polariscopes. Right. Now let us see that plain polariscope. Which is plain polariscope? Now in that plain polariscope, we do have some components. And that components as shown in this figure, you can see. So we do have first one light source. This is light source. So there used to be one light source through which light can be produced, and we need to have a monochromatic light or polarizer. Okay, so we need to have this polarizer through which polarized light can be passed through, or monochromatic source of light. Generally, we must have one monochromatic source of light. Okay, so this type of light source where it is once we are going for some type of diffusion, then also we can obtain monochromatic source. Monochromatic source means it should be of single wavelength. Okay. So a light source will be there, and even white light also we can use it, because white light is used for producing fringe patterns, color. It produces more number of colors. So we can produce more number of fringe patterns in this. Okay. So that is the light source we need to have compulsorily. Then we will be having a polarizer. So this is the polarizer, which is the, you can say, or a polarized filter, which will be producing polarized light. So it will make the particles to move only in a single direction. Right? Okay. Then next one, this polarized light will be passing through. It has to pass through that loaded specimen. So the specimen or the test specimen will be kept in between. And the polarized light will be passed through it. And then next one, again, we'll be having another polarizer, or which we call it as analyzer. Now, the difference between this polarizer and analyzer is what? that this axis of this polarizer and axis of this polarizer is crossed, not in same direction. Otherwise, what will be there? The light will be passing through it. Okay, so we'll be discussing on that light field and dark field that I will tell you. So these two axes of this polarizer will be crossed so that no light will be passing through it and it will produce a dark field here. Okay, so light will not be passing through it. It will produce a dark field. And in this, you can say so that all the light should pass through the specimen. And whatever pattern will be developed, it will be only due to this specimen, not due to this polarizer. Okay, and here we will have one screen, you can say, or detector, image detector. It may be a camera also. It may be a camera film where it everything will be recorded. So here we'll be having a detector. Okay, so detector. Okay, so detector will be there here. One detector, right? Now we will be going for circular polariscope. So in that circular polariscope, next one it is there. In this circular polariscope, what we are having, a light source, as we have seen in linear polariscope also, and in this circular polariscope, so circular polarization, we have already discussed about linear polarization, we have already discussed about circular polarization. So this circular polarization, in this it is produced, which will be covering complete, you can say, specimen. Now, one more thing I will tell you here, that why there is a need of this plane polariscope and why there is a need of this circular polariscope. So plane polariscope, in that actually we do have two types of fringe patterns. Two types of fringe patterns will be developed, showing different colors. One is called isochromatics and another one is called isoclinics. Okay. So these two terms are very important in my next slides and all. It is already there and we will be having a discussion on that. So that isochromatic and isoclinic, both of them are merging together in this linear, or you can say plane polariscope, due to this linear polarization, you can say. So due to this linear polarization, both the axis of isoclinics and isochromatics, both are merging together. So the pattern of shear stress will not be able to find out properly. Okay, so that is the main thing is there. We are not in a position to find out properly. And sometimes we need to separate it by utilizing some another methodology. So that's why in circular polariscope, what actually it is there, that isoclinics. So isoclinics will be cancelled. Isoclinics will be separated out. Only isochromatic patterns will be there. So that isochromatic pattern is of much use, which is giving the magnitude of shear stress. Which is giving the magnitude of shear stress, whereas isoclinics is giving the direction of shear stress. Okay. So isoclinics are giving the direction of shear stress. So in circular polariscope, we do have light source again. So about light source, we have already discussed. Then we do have collimating lens. Collimating lens means it will expand the source, the light which is coming here. It will be expanding it. Okay. So in order to have an expansion, the lens, because we need to have the light which can cover the material completely. Full material should get covered completely. Okay, so this collimating lens is used, and this polarizer, again polarizer is there, so polarized light will be produced. You are already knowing that what is polarized light. Okay, so here circular polarization will be there. So circular polarization, and then we do have one quarter wave plate. Okay, so a very important it is. So two types of wave plates are being used here. Okay, quarter wave plates are used, two quarter wave plates are used here, whereas we were not using any type of wave plate there earlier. Here we are using quarter wave plate. Then in between, some type of mechanism will be there, in which we will be able to load, because we need to load the material, and then only we will be able to find the pattern. We will be able to find the pattern. So what will be the purpose of this quarter wave plate? Its purpose is to separate that isoclinic and isochromatic. So that isochromatic, you can say that fringes will be developed by this specimen, and isoclinics will be getting completely separated. So isoclinics, as I told you, that it gives the direction of the shear stress, and this will be giving you isochromatics will give you magnitude of shear stress. So by having this loading pattern, we can have it. So this is the purpose of quarter wave plate. So there used to be half wave plate also, there used to be quarter wave plate also. So now that quarter wave plate through which isochromatics light will be going through, and as I told you that this polarizer and analyzer, its axis will be in, it will be aligned such that it will be crossing each other and not in the same line. Otherwise, full light will pass through the analyzer and this detector, and no fringe pattern will be produced. So there used to be a bright pattern and dark field is there. Dark field and light field used to be there. So that light field means what? The light which is passing through, it will pass through the specimen, it will be passing through the analyzer, and it will cross through. So fully it will be called as light field. And then we will not be able to have any type of image. Any type of fringe pattern will not be developed. Now that this axis of the analyzer, if this is the axis of this, this polarizer, axis of this polarizer, then it will be having a different, crossed axis, so that there will be a dark field setup will be there. Due to that dark field setup, all light will be passing through this test specimen. And as separation already has taken place for, isochromatic and isoclinics, so isochromatic patterns will be developed through this specimen. And again in this quarter wave plate, again that isoclinics and isochromatics both will be combined together, and it will be observed in the analyzer, or this will be the actually analyzer, which is just polarizer only, which is like polarizer only. And again here field lines are there. So here this collimatic lens were used to expand the light, to expand the light source. The light source has got expanded to cover complete material or test specimen. So this, the purpose of this field lines will be to convert that expanded beam of light in such a way that it should get accommodated in the image detector. It will be getting accommodated in the image detector. So that is the purpose of field lens. And here expansion was the purpose of collimating lens. So this is called circular polariscope. So here the isochromatic and isoclinic, both fringe patterns were separated. As I told you that isochromatic, which is the very most important pattern, fringe pattern, which gives you the magnitude of shear stress, whereas isoclinic is giving mere direction of shear stress. So here direction also can be found out, and magnitude also we will be able to find out. Whereas in plain polariscope, both are mixed together. So there is a need to separate isoclinic and isochromatic. So that is one additional task is being involved there. Okay, right. So as I told about fields and axis, so there used to be light field, dark field, fast axis and slow axis. Okay, so light field, when the, one polarizer, and analyzer, suppose this is the axis, and if this is the axis of this polarizer, this is polarizer and this is analyzer, and suppose this axis is analyzer's axis is rotated in such a way that it will produce only light. It will pass, the light which is passing through this polarizer also will be passing through this analyzer and will go to the detector. Okay, so in that case it will be called as light field, and even if we are keeping that material in between, we will not be able to produce any type of pattern here. So there will not be any isochromating and isoclinic patterns will be developed in this detector. Dark field, when the axis of this analyzer is rotated in such a way that the light is not passing through this analyzer, it is blocked somewhere here. Somewhere in this region it is blocked. If it is blocked in this region, so complete light will be passing through, it will be penetrating the specimen, and then whatever the light will be coming out, that will produce fringe pattern. That will be producing fringe pattern on the image detector. Earlier in light field, the light was passing through the polarizer and then specimen and analyzer, and on the detector simply light has come. There was no fringe pattern. But when this dark field is set up by rotating the axis of the analyzer, by creating a dark field here, then the fringe pattern of this particular specimen is being developed in the detector. Okay, right. Now about fast axis and slow axis. Now suppose if this is the light source, and this light source, if it is passing through a polarizer, then in this case, this light particles, you can say, is getting separated into two components. Getting separated into two components. So one component, C1, and another component, C2. In this, this particular component will be called as fast axis. Fast axis. So that is the main reason behind we are talking about isochromatic and isoclinic pattern. So one will be in the axis of fast axis and another one will become slow axis. So this is called fast axis and slow axis. So separation of the components will be taking place, and in one axis there will be isochromatic pattern will be there. So isochromatic pattern will be developed in this fast axis. Isochromatic. Whereas in this slow axis, okay, so isoclinics pattern will be, fringe pattern will be developed. Isoclinics, as I told you, so it shows that direction of the shear stress, and isochromatic will be giving you magnitude of shear stress. Okay, so as I told, there are two types, isochromatic and isoclinic. So one is giving you magnitude of shear stress vector, and another one is direction of shear stress vector. Okay, so my students, they would be thinking that what actually is the fringe pattern. So fringe pattern is, as I will tell you, this is the screen, you can say, screen. Okay, and now suppose this is the point source of light, and with this point source of light, if suppose you are utilizing some type of slits here, so this is actually just like Young's double slit experiment. Okay, so this light source is passing through these slits. Light is passing through these slits, and after passing through these slits, it will become monochromatic light. Okay, before that it is not monochromatic light. Here, after passing through these slits, it will become monochromatic light, and the light will be going to like this here. So it will produce a, you can say, bright pattern here. bright. Bright fringes. Okay. Then another place like this, here it will be there. Okay. So here it is dark fringe. Dark fringes. Okay. So here it will be produced as dark fringe. Here it is bright fringe. So alternate bright, then dark, then again bright, again dark. Like this fringe patterns will be developed. So that fringe patterns will be like this. So some type of like this lines will be developed. So, and then dark portion will be there. And again, some bright fringes like this patterns will be there. Again, dark region will be there. Again, some like this. So bright, sorry, dark, again bright. Again dark, sorry, here dark, again here bright. So like this alternate fringes patterns will be developed. So that is called fringe pattern. Okay.